And welcome everybody to another edition of the Brody File. Look where we are. We're in Colorado for our annual holiday show. It is the best political interviews that we've done this year. So thanks for joining us. We have nothing. It's been a pleasure. No, we have some stuff. We're the Brody File. We go into full stalking mode. You know that. And by the way, we're in Colorado. So can I just say, look at this. I got the purple tie. Do we see that? We see the tie. I mean, obviously we see the tie. Why purple? It's Colorado. It's not red. It's not blue. It's kind of purple. And so therefore the subliminal message. All right, let's get to it. Our first political interview, Ben Carson. He's like a walking chamomile tea. I mean, this guy is just like calm as can be. He's cool as a cucumber. Can I give any other analogies? Anyhow, here's some of our conversation. We like to call it one of the best political interviews of 2015. Dr. Ben Carson is known as a straight shooter, whether it's pool or talking politics.
Obamacare is really, I think, the worst thing that has happened in this nation since slavery.
His no-nonsense approach captivates conservative audiences, and now the massively organized Draft Ben Carson for President movement has positioned him near the top of presidential polls. Indeed, it looks like he might be ready to move from medicine to politics. But first, he says God would have to grab him by the collar.
And how is that conversation going with God about this potential presidential run? Has he grabbed you by the collar yet? I read an article about that.
I feel fingers.
A presidential run would only add to Carson's achievements.
My life has been truly amazing. I think about it all the time.
His well-documented journey is told in the book and movie Gifted Hands. It begins in Detroit, where he was raised by a single mom, poor grades followed, along with a violent temper that led him to a stabbing incident with a friend. On that day, the knife miraculously hit the boy's belt buckle, giving young Ben Carson another chance to turn his life around. And he took it. Alone in his house, he picked up a Bible, gave his life to Jesus, and asked the Lord to take away his violent temper.
Never had another anger problem since that day. And some people say you just learn how to cover it up, but when the Lord fixes a problem, he fixes it. He didn't do a paint job. So, you know, it's virtually impossible to make me angry now.
And if the doctor becomes a presidential candidate, he says his cool demeanor is going to help him.
I'm not going to take the bait. I'm not going to get angry. It's just not going to happen.
This could be the essence of a Carson for President campaign. A calm doctor dispensing ideas and leading a conversation on pressing issues, seeking reconciliation.
Americans have to recognize that we, the American people, are not each other's enemies. The enemies are those people who try to divide everybody up.
For example, those calling pro-lifers anti-women or traditional marriage supporters anti-gay.
They've been reading a book by Saul Alinsky called Rules for Radicals, which says never have a conversation with your enemies because that humanizes them. And your job is to demonize them.
Candy Carson, his wife of nearly 40 years, knows that her husband will be demonized by his critics if he runs. She understands the stakes.
Our country is going a way that's different from what our founding fathers were thinking, and we wanted to make sure he felt really called to wake people up. And that's what he's been doing.
The Carsons plan to lean on their Christian faith to get them through.
You know, in the Bible it says the Lord doesn't give you more than you can handle, right? And a lot of times you feel like, are you sure? Are you really sure? You know, but he does give you what you need.
We recognize that, you know, we are being instruments in the hand of God. He is the one who really orchestrates all of this.
Right now, Carson is putting together his platform. He wants a fairer and flatter tax structure, lower corporate taxes, and health savings accounts for all. But his number one issue, the out-of-control debt.
Unless we get a grip on that, why wouldn't we suffer the same fates as other pinnacle nations who have allowed debt to encumber their progress?
Carson also will not let political correctness get in his way. He plans to speak his mind on issues like the roots of this country.
We are, in fact, a Judeo-Christian nation. And I think that's a huge part of our strength.
Or comparing our current government to Nazi Germany.
And I know you're not supposed to say Nazi Germany, but I don't care about political correctness.
He talks straight about President Obama, too.
Our president is very much like Putin, you know. Oh, well, gee, there's no resistance here. I'll just keep going. And the resistance needs to be there.
What would you want to tell him?
I would want to tell him, sir, I understand that you have very defined ideals of what you think America is. But you work for the people. They don't work for you.
Constitutional authority, he has overstepped that, you believe, in many instances?
Without question. And hopefully, the legislators in Congress will understand what they need to do.
What do they need to do?
They need to have a spine. They need to stand up. Because once you allow someone to take liberties with the system, they're not going to stop.
Carson says it's up to the people to change America's direction.
People need to recognize that they do have power, but they do have to exercise it. It is our God-given duty to exercise that power.
And he's praying for God to show his power in a mighty way.
You think this country needs a spiritual awakening?
We most definitely need a spiritual awakening. I mean, look at the direction that we're going in. Mm-hmm. Absolute absurdity.
And the good doctor seems ready to tackle that absurdity in the wild world of presidential politics.
And there it is.
That is Ben Carson here on the Brody File. All right, when the holiday edition of the Brody File rolls on, we have another big political interview of the year. You know this is coming. Donald Trump, the golf course, huge, a wonderful interview, one of the best I've ever done. Back in a moment. And welcome, everybody, to the Brody File Holiday Edition here in Colorado. We're doing the best political interviews of 2015 here on the Brody File. One of the highlights had to be Donald Trump, the golf course, right there in Southern California. Oh, by the way, he owns it, newsflash. And he took us out to the 18th hole, and we did a little walking around. We saw the grounds. We went inside to do an interview. We were everywhere. It was truly one of the most remarkable times that the Brody File crew really had all of this year, quite frankly, in a few years. And here's some of the interview.
Amazing. Thank you. Wow.
He has proven the political world wrong. Not only have the name Donald Trump and GOP frontrunner appeared in the same sentence, they've stayed together. And then there's this.
I'm leading with the evangelicals, Big League.
It's true. Poll after poll shows Trump ahead among self-identified evangelicals.
I think one of the reasons I'm doing so well, I am a Christian, I'm a Protestant, I'm a Presbyterian, I'm a total believer. I believe in the Bible, I believe in God, and I think I will help them so much with this country.
But with proven evangelical-type candidates already out there, like Ben Carson, Ted Cruz, and Mike Huckabee, Trump has some work to do.
I brought my Bible. Okay.
He placed fifth at the recent Values Voter Summit, even though he's not exactly your standard evangelical candidate. He's been married 3 times. He used to be pro-choice, though now he's pro-life. His healthy ego rubs some the wrong way, and cutting comments about fellow candidates ruffle some feathers, too.
Jeb Bush is a low-energy person. For him, to get things done is hard.
Trump tells us he's working on his tone.
You need a person of tremendous strength, but I think I could tone it down a little bit and I'll try.
For sure, evangelicals respond to his fighting spirit and ability to cut through the political hot air.
You know exactly where he stands, whether you agree with him or not. That's what I love about Donald Trump.
Donald Trump tells it like he sees it, and I think people, at least on this first impression of Donald Trump, is that he's not going to be controlled by the political class. And that's what they're looking for.
I've dealt with very tough hombres and very tough people, and I've come out on top, and I can understand the evangelicals to a certain extent saying, well, maybe he's not as nice as we want him to be, but they also want to see the country be great.
They also are curious about Trump's faith journey, something that we discussed on his golf course in California.
Who is God to you? What are some of your thoughts on this?
God is the ultimate. I mean, God created this. Yeah. And, you know, here's the Pacific Ocean right behind us. So,
Nobody, no thing, no, there's nothing like God.
On the campaign trail, he calls the Bible his number one book.
The Bible is special. The Bible, the more you see it, the more you read it, the more incredible it is.
What about prayer? Are you a praying guy? I mean, do you pray once in a while?
Tell me about that
and maybe some Bible reading.
I am
reading.
A praying guy, and very interestingly, the other thing I have, and I found this, but this is this is my confirmation class, June 1959, which is pretty good, right? So, no, I am a praying person.
Are there certain things that you really feel like you need to pray for?
I think more than anything for the family and for health.
As for mercy, his critics went after him when he told an evangelical audience this summer that he wasn't sure he ever asked God for forgiveness.
Do you believe that it's important to ask God for forgiveness? How do you feel
about
that?
Well, I do. I think it's great. And I consider communion to be a very important thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I go to church and I take communion, I consider that asking for forgiveness in my own way.
Trump talks fondly about his Sunday school days, though he admits these days he goes to church when he can. While evangelicals may never see him as Pastor Trump, they do want to see more substance, especially on issues like the rights of Christian business owners.
How concerned are you about their religious liberty rights that are under attack if they don't want to bake a cake for
a gay
wedding?
You're right, and I'm very concerned about it. And a lot of, you know, there's going to be a lot of law issued about it.
And speaking of the law, Trump disagrees with the Supreme Court's ruling on same-sex marriage.
We have some very terrible Supreme Court justices, and frankly, they should have at least had that as a state's right issue.
But Trump does consider gay marriage the law of the land, and that does put him at odds with some of his evangelical rivals. Eventually, conservative Christian voters will render their verdict on Trump and all the others.
I'm praying about it, honestly. I'm asking the Lord what he wants me to do, and I think that that's what all Christians need to do.
Meanwhile, Trump will continue preaching his message and pray that evangelicals buy in.
You're special people, and I love you all, and this is the key. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Donald Trump here on the Brody File. All right, when we come back, Marco Rubio, watch out for him. I think he's the sleeper, folks. He just lurks. It's kind of like that movie, What Lies Beneath. Marco Rubio on the Brody File, that interview next. And welcome back, everybody, to the holiday show here on the Brody File. All right, time for our interview with Marco Rubio. We did this over the summer in June. You know, here at the Brody File, we don't just follow the news. We actually make the news, and the rest of the country follows the news. And boy, did Marco Rubio make some news when he talked to us. Have a look.
Senator Marco Rubio.
Florida Senator Marco Rubio sees Iowa as the first stop on his road to the White House. It's the ultimate American dream, and for this 43-year-old, the future is now.
I have been told by some people, you know, why don't you wait? You know, the you could be the candidate of the future. And my answer is, well, that's good news, because this election's in the future.
And that philosophy will be the centerpiece of his presidential run, with the campaign theme, A New American Century.
We are engaged in a massive global competition for investment and for innovation, and we are falling behind because our government has policies that are holding us back.
Rubio supporters see him as an American success story. Raised in a Spanish-speaking home to Cuban-born parents, he grew up as part of the working class. After arriving in America, both parents worked hard. Their rich family spirit made up for any financial shortcomings. A lesson that sticks with him to this day.
First of all, the family is the original cell of society. In essence, it is the first and most important government. It's the first church. Mm-hmm. The family is the singular most important institution in society. It existed before government. It existed before laws. Mm.
A strong faith is also key. He grew up Roman Catholic, though at one point the family tried Mormonism. Rubio tells me that didn't feel right.
As I got more theologically aware and more engaged in learning about Catholicism, I wanted to go back, and so we did.
As a young adult, Rubio admits he fell away from his faith, so his wife started attending a Baptist church. They went there for a number of years, but eventually Rubio felt a tug back to his Catholic roots.
In an ironic way, the more I learned about the written word, the more I fell in love with the Roman Catholic teachings. Mm. And we've ended up going back to that church. And so today we're in a place where we're Roman Catholics, fully aligned with the theology and the magisterium, the teaching authority of the church, but also with a tremendous appreciation for and often interaction with our brothers and sisters in Christ who attend other denominations.
Today, his deep faith drives public policy decisions on social issues, like traditional marriage.
We are at the water's edge of the argument that mainstream Christian teaching is hate speech. Hmm.
because today we've reached the point in our society where if you do not support same-sex marriage, you are labeled a homophobe and a hater. So what's the next step after that? After they've done going after individuals, the next step is to argue that the teachings of mainstream Christianity, the catechism of the Catholic Church, is hate speech. And that's a real and present danger.
And Rubio says he's ready to face danger, not just here, but around the world.
You don't want to be engaged in every conflict on the planet. Sure. We're not the world's policemen. But I question what would happen in the alternative. If America doesn't lead, for example, what happens? Well, what happens is chaos.
His positions and early standing in the polls put Rubio in a good position, even this early in the race. His backers like a general election scenario of a young Marco Rubio versus Hillary Clinton, who's been around a while. He does face some challenges, though, with the base, specifically his work with Democrats on comprehensive immigration reform. It's something that he knew could hurt his chances of becoming president when we discussed this issue 2 years ago.
It's a political reality of what could potentially happen.
Well, the day I start making decisions around here with the mind towards what other office I want to run for, I'll no longer be very effective.
Another challenge? His latest tax plan, which has some conservatives complaining that he would leave tax rates too high. But challenges are nothing new to Rubio. Politically, he defeated former Florida Governor Charlie Crist in 2010 to win his Senate seat. Personally, he rose to the challenge when one day he suddenly came to the rescue of his son.
I walk outside and I turn to the left and I look in the pool and Dominic is floating at the top face down. And you can just imagine how horrifying that was. And so I jumped in, I pulled him out. He immediately started crying. Obviously, you know, threw up all the water he had swallowed and everything was fine. But, you know, to this day, it tortures me to think if I had been in the shower or anything else, what would have happened there? It was just, you know, God's hand that protected him.
That moment crystallized the importance of family in his life.
One day I will no longer be in politics. One day I will no longer be a senator or a president or anything else. Mm. But I will always be a father and I will always be a husband.
As for president, well, he'll leave that up to the American people. Oh, and Almighty God.
You ready for the slings and arrows? It's coming. It's a whole different ballgame, you know.
Yeah. I mean, so ultimately my view of it is you go out, you do the very best you can, and ultimately it's going to turn out the way voters and God decide.
Marco Rubio here on the Brody File talking marriage and religious liberty, and there were a lot of New York Times and Washington Post articles about that interview when it happened. All right, when we come back, Carly Fiorina, she's doing pretty well in the polls. She's also talking about Jesus with the Brody File. That is next. And welcome, everybody, back to the holiday show here on the Brody File from Colorado. Doing the best political interviews of the year. One of them had to be with Carly Fiorina. This was before she got in the race. She was talking Jesus. And she really opened up about some of the tragedies in her life and how she recommitted her life to Jesus Christ. Have a look at some of this.
Your faith journey, and you know, join the crowd when I'm sure we're a bit like this. I mean, boy, we all just kind of go through it, ups and downs. So that's what life is, I guess. Tell me a little bit about yours, because I know that, especially in that 2009, 2010 period, breast cancer, Lorianne, what was that like for you and what kind of low points and maybe eventually rising from the ashes, kind of higher points you took? If you can share that with
us. Well, battling cancer and the death of our younger daughter, Lorianne, I am quite certain that I would not have been able to endure those without a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm just certain of that. And I am forever grateful that I rediscovered a personal relationship with God before that happened. Mm. I grew up knowing I had a personal relationship with Jesus. I prayed every day all my life, but somehow in the course of my life, it got a little bit more abstract for me. Mm-hmm. And I came to think of God sort of as a CEO, you know, they couldn't pay attention to every detail, but generally speaking, things were working the right way.
Right.
But how could Jesus know what was really going on mm-hmm. with me? And how could God answer my prayers specifically? And then I had a pastor friend who pushed me really hard on that. And so it caused me to think about how could I be convinced that God has a personal relationship with each of us through Jesus Christ. Hmm. And one, it sounds corny, but it's true. On a Christmas Eve midnight mass, I prayed for a sign, help me resolve this. Mm-hmm. And on that Christmas morning, I woke up and it was like a revelation that, you know, if human beings can create a global positioning system that keeps track of billions and billions and billions of moving people and things in every millisecond and provides precise instructions around where you ought to be going, make a legal U-turn at the next available opportunity. If people can do that, God can do that. Mm-hmm. God can keep track of us all. God can tell us where to go. We have to listen. So,
yeah.
I know that I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and I know that God answers the prayers that He should. And that has been proven to me over and over and over again, especially during those dark times.
Carly Fiorina here on the Brody File. We have our eye on Carly. Get it? Well, if you don't get it, you're probably over 40. Check with your kids. Nickelodeon, they get it, believe me. Just say iCarly and you'll ask whatever. It's a conversation. All right, back in a moment from the Year in Review. All right, that does it for this week and quite frankly, for 2015. New Year's resolution for the Brody File, lose weight. Other than that, we hope this reality series of a presidential campaign continues. Have a great week. God bless. We'll see you next time in 2016, or as they say, see you next year.